Hi, I'm Dr. Leslie Blankenship Williams, and in this lecture, I am going to introduce you to the study and scope of microbiology and juxtapose that with a historical perspective on the field of microbiology. So let's go ahead and start by defining microbiology. What is microbiology? Well, ology, or the suffix ology, means study of, and microbiology, therefore, is the study of microbes. So let's go ahead and write that in. Okay, that's pretty easy to define. Now the more difficult question is, what are microbes? In other words, what types of things are encompassed in the study of microbiology? Now that's a little bit more complicated, so I'm going to go ahead and take you to another page, and we're going to go ahead and write some notes down. Okay, so the first thing to note is that, as you might expect, the word micro means very small. So typically, if something is living that requires a microscope to view it, it would be encompassed in the field of microbiology. So as I said, the first thing is that anything that is living, but is so small that it requires a microscope to view and therefore is microscopic, would be included in the study of microbiology. But it turns out that that is not the complete definition. There are some other things that are also included in the study of microbiology. And these can be living organisms that are actually larger and can be viewed with the naked eye, and non-living agents as well. So if you are something that causes disease, and more specifically infectious disease, there's many different types of disease out there, like autoimmune disease, cancer, etc. But infectious disease is specifically caused by a pathogen. So if you cause infectious disease, you are studied in microbiology. And this would include some larger organisms like worms that could be visible to the naked eye. In other words, you would not need a microscope to view them. And it also includes some non-living entities or agents, such as viruses. Now, because we are going to be focused mostly on infectious diseases, after all, this is a microbiology class geared for allied health professionals, we aren't going to spend a whole lot of time looking at things that are not related to disease. We will spend just a little bit of time on them, but not too much. If you were to take this course at a four-year university where it was more generic microbiology, you would cover other organisms such as algae and protists and bacteria that don't cause disease. But from our perspective, what is useful to you as the student, we're going to be focusing mostly on category number two. Now with that, let's go ahead and take a look at some different types of microbes and their relative sizes. So most microbes are going to be very, very small. And the two most common groups of infectious pathogens that we are going to encounter will be bacteria and viruses. Now, in a general biology class, you probably learned about the typical cell. Most cells that comprise the human body are in fact smaller than what you could view with your naked eye, so you would still need a microscope to see them. But one of the things that you might notice is that bacteria are actually considerably smaller than typical human cells. And viruses are much, much smaller. So small that they actually fall out of the range of the light microscope. So in lab, we are going to be using light microscopes to view bacteria, but viruses are too small to be visible even with a light microscope. We would need a special type of microscope called an electron microscope to be able to view a virus. So unfortunately, we're still going to be limited to what types of microbes we can even view with a typical light microscope, as we would see in lab. Now that we've looked at that, let's go ahead and draw out or categorize the various types of microbes that we are going to encounter in this class. So I'm going to go ahead and make a flowchart. I encourage you to do this as well. So let's go ahead and make a list of potential microbes. So the first way that I'm going to break this out is by whether or not they are living. In other words, are they living organisms? And then over here, I'm going to put non-living, at least not by our definition of what is alive. Now, in the non-living category, we have two major outcroppings. The largest of those is going to be viruses. So viruses are infectious particles that are non-living. Now viruses can do some things that are similar to living organisms, such as reproduce, but they don't satisfy all of the criteria required to be considered alive, such as ability to sense and respond to an environment, do your own chemical reactions, that type of stuff. So we still consider them to be non-living, even though in many ways they mimic living creatures. The other group is even less like a cell and is more esoteric and not encountered frequently, but when it is, can create some pretty devastating diseases. And this group is called the prions. Now, perhaps the most famous example of a prion would be mad cow disease. Okay, let's go ahead and take a look at the living side, which is going to have a lot more branches to it. So the first thing that we're going to do is we are going to break this out into two different types of building blocks. So remember, all living creatures are built of cells, and cells can come in two types. One type is called a prokaryotic cell. These are more simple cells. And then the larger, more complicated or complex cells are called eukaryotic cells. Now, within the prokaryotic cells, we have two major taxa that are going to be included. And these are actually their own separate domains. One is bacteria, which everybody hopefully has heard of. But the other is a group that was more recently discovered called archaea. Now, archaea are also prokaryotic cells, but they are evolutionarily distinct from bacteria. While we can have archaea as part of our what's called microflora, these are the prokaryotes and sometimes eukaryotes that live on and around our bodies, they don't usually cause disease, so we don't spend a lot of time on them. But it is important to know that there's another prokaryotic lineage out there called archaea that is going to be studied typically in microbiology, though again, because they don't cause infectious disease, we're not going to be spending a whole lot of time on them. Now, on the eukaryotic side, you may have learned about something called kingdoms. So in fact, you may have learned that the eukarya, which are the more complicated cells, are broken down into four major kingdoms, and they are animals, plants, fungi, and then the leftover group collectively known as protists. So let's go ahead and write those down. So which of these kingdoms are going to be covered in microbiology? Well, as it turns out, not all of them. So remember, to be covered in the field of microbiology, you need to either be so small that you require a microscope to view, or you need to be infectious. So let's go ahead and go through these. Are animals microscopic? Not typically. They can be, but typically they're not. Are they infectious? They can be. And so this would include things like ticks or lice, sometimes are covered in microbiology, but more often we see infectious worms. So these can infect your blood, they can infect your digestive system. Tapeworm is an example. Now tapeworm is definitely visible to the naked eye, but because it is infectious, it is covered in microbiology. So we are going to include the worms here. Now, what about plants? Well, plants are not microscopic. They can't be because they need access to the sun. So if they were so small that they couldn't get access to the sun, they wouldn't be doing very well. So plants are not microscopic, but are they infectious? And the answer is no, never. And you say, but wait, what about poison oak and poison ivy? Aren't they infectious? No, they are not. To be infectious means that you would transmit a disease, or you could transmit a disease through some pathway. And although they can cause disease, it's not through infection. It is through a response to toxins that are in the leaves of either poison oak or poison ivy. So plants are not covered. Now, what about fungi? So fungi, you might think mushrooms. Okay, mushrooms are fungi. Have you ever seen a mushroom growing out of somebody who's alive? I haven't. But that doesn't mean they're not covered. Turns out that mushrooms, or all fungi, have an extensive body shape that's basically just like a spider web of cells. And these can be microscopic, but more importantly, some of them are infectious. And the most commonly known infectious fungus is, in fact, yeast. Not baker's yeast, the yeast that causes infections. So if you hear about a yeast infection, that's actually a type of fungus. So fungi are going to be covered. And there's more than just yeast, but yeast is going to be kind of the classic one that we would look at. Now, protists are going to be a leftover hodgepodge group of eukaryotes that are defined by not being animals, plants, or fungi. That's actually the definition. They tend to be very small. Many of them are truly microscopic, meaning they are one-cell individuals. And many of those are also infectious. So protists are definitely also going to be covered. I'll just put a little check there. We're definitely covering some protists. The most classic protist that you might find or that you might be aware of already is malaria. Malaria is actually not caused by a bacteria, but rather a protist. All right, now that we've taken a look at what's going to be covered, let me show you some quick pictures. So here we have just some pictures of bacteria in lab. We are commonly going to encounter bacteria on petri dishes. We'll be growing them under a microscope. They'll look more like this. And then viruses, which are too small to be seen with a light microscope, use a special type of microscope to generate images such as this. Now that's the really small stuff, but don't forget that eukaryotes are also going to be included. And here are some examples. So here I have a fungus. This is a protist. This is a type of algae over here. This is an amoeba. That's another protist. And this is the head of a tapeworm. All right, that concludes the first part of this lecture, which covers the scope of microbiology.